So your network has grown. You added devices, containers, routers, PCs, whatever. But you don't want things to go belly up because a disk was full or a link on your switch or router was down. Why did the device not tell me before? Rather than just stopping and leaving a line in the event log saying, "Sorry pal, my disk is full," it could have told me that before, right? That's what monitoring and alerting is for. Good for you. There is an awesome open source solution called Zabbix for this. And because it is awesome open source, Brian from the awesome open source YouTube channel and myself decided to do these episodes together. So if you have not seen the teaser video last week, or if you don't know the awesome open source YouTube channel, then here's a link for you where Brian actually shows us in his very unique and patient way how to install Zabbix and how to get it up and running in no time. Please check it out and make sure you leave him a like and a comment on his channel. Many thanks. So why and how do I use Zabbix? Why not Prometheus and Grafana, like many other YouTubers suggest? I found those solutions a bit oversized, really, for my home lab environment. Plus, they are lacking two or three features which I really love with Zabbix. First off, I don't want to define all the devices and metrics by hand. I would want to scan my network and have the devices be added to the graphical user interface automatically. Also, I don't really fancy defining stuff in text files. I want a user interface for that. And last but not least, I would love to use that tool not only for monitoring and alerting, but also as an inventory. Zabbix gives me all that. Here is how I use Zabbix. When I start Zabbix, then the first thing that I look at is the monitoring dashboard. Are there any problems? If yes, then they show up here in different colors here in the Zabbix UI, depending on the severity. If I click on one of those, then I can ad hoc see how things developed here over time. If I have configured alerting, then I would also receive a text or mail from Zabbix outlining the problem. I can also go directly to the host list, which I can filter by groups, like I put all Proxmox containers into one group, for example. I could pick one of those and see the latest data that has been collected. Let's take this eBus container here. That one collects data from my heating system. Looking at the disk space, you can see that there is something filling up the disk over time. In this case, it's an ever-growing log file that never gets truncated. On my routers and Wi-Fi access points, I can quickly access data such as the throughput of the Wi-Fi interfaces. On my switches, I can see the status and throughput for each single port. There is, of course, much, much more, but I'm not trying to feature sell Zabbix to you. I think it's much easier if you tried it out for yourself. If you have not watched the first episode on the awesome open source YouTube channel, then you might as well install it following the instructions on the Zabbix.com website. But honestly, there are a couple of catches, so it's really much easier to watch Brian's video and follow the steps there. Cool, now that we have Zabbix up and running, we want to start monitoring our servers, containers, and network devices. But the only host that we have available in the host list is our Zabbix server itself. We could now, of course, create every single host in the network by clicking on that blue Create Host button in the Zabbix UI. But that's a bit of a tedious task. Let's rather go and have Zabbix scan our network and create the host entries automatically for us. For this, we go to Configuration in the Zabbix UI, then to Discovery. You can see that there is already a rule which Zabbix created called Local Network. The network to be scanned is set to the subnet which my Zabbix host is in. Let's tick the Enabled box here at the bottom. Now we go to Actions, then Discovery Actions, and click on Create Action. Here, we can tell Zabbix what it should do with discovered hosts. I want Zabbix to create a host entry in my inventory for every entry it finds. So here, under Conditions, I click on Add. The type of the condition is Discovery Rule. I click on Select and choose the rule which I had just enabled. On the Operations tab, I can now have Zabbix perform an action. I click on Add again. As an operation, I just select Add Host. We'll talk about all the other options later. We would now expect Zabbix to actually scan the network and add the hosts. But if you go to Monitoring and then Discovery, then you won't see any hosts being added. Let's check why. We go back to the Configuration, then Discovery tab, and select the Local Network rule again. In this box here, that is titled Checks, you can see that it is actually scanning the network for hosts that have the Zabbix agent installed. So in fact, it's scanning the network for open ports 10050. But at this moment, we do not have any Zabbix agent anywhere. We'll do that later. So let's rather do something more generic. I remove the Zabbix agent tests and add three new ones. ICMP ping, HTTP on port 80, and SSH on port 22. So what I want Zabbix to do is that it pings all hosts and checks if HTTP port 80 or 22 is open. I'll also change the interval to 5 minutes. You can even change this to 1 minute for starters. That's it, guys. For a more detailed explanation of each single field and example rules, please see the Zabbix documentation chapter 15, part 1. Now, I've seen it happen that nothing changes here under monitoring discovery. Restarting the server with systemctl restart Zabbix server did the trick. In a Docker version service, well, you would just restart the container really. Nevertheless, this will now take a long time. You will see hosts being added gradually to the Zabbix interface. Time to take a coffee or go for a walk with a dog. After a while, you should see that list fill up. Awesome! The list has filled up and now it's time to configure the hosts for Zabbix. If we go to Monitoring, then Hosts in the Zabbix UI, then we can see the newly added hosts here. You can see that they all have this grayed out ZBX icon here. That's because there is no agent yet. We'll come to that. Now, let's first click on any of those discovered hosts and select Configuration. We can change a couple of obvious values here, such as the visible name if I don't want the host to be shown in lists with this DNS name. I strongly advise you to keep the host name as is. Maybe later you would want to use Zabbix as an inventory for Ansible. It will then come in handy if the host name is a proper DNS name. We can also assign the host to a group. Zabbix has created the group Discovered Hosts here, but I can assign it to any host group, which I can also customize under Configuration, Host Groups. Now for the interesting part, templates. We don't want to define all the metrics that we want to collect from that host, like CPU, memory, disk space, etc. manually. For this, there are a huge number of templates readily available in Zabbix. If you click on Select next to Templates and then again on Select in the dialog box, then you get a list of theme-based templates here. Let's select Templates. Now I get a nice list of predefined templates for various vendors like Cisco, MikroTik or HP and many others. There's also templates for operating systems such as Linux or Windows. In my case, I select Linux by Zabbix agent, as I will be monitoring a Linux device. Note that there is a passive and an active template here. In fact, the Zabbix agent on the remote device can be active. That means it's initiating the connection to the Zabbix server. Or it can be passive. That means that it just listens on port 10050 and waits for the Zabbix server to connect. I use the passive one for local servers and the active one for laptops, for example. That's it for the moment. Amazing! The host is configured and all I need in order to collect data from it is to install the Zabbix agent on it. Let me quickly do this on two devices. One is a Linux box and the other one is my sandbox router that is running OpenWRT. Let me do the router first. On OpenWRT, the Zabbix agent is available as a software package. So I log into the OpenWRT user interface, select System, then Software, potentially update the list and search for Zabbix. Fun fact here, I could even run the Zabbix server on my OpenWRT router. But here, I'm only after the Zabbix agent. That's the first package here, Zabbix-agentd. Furthermore, I want to also install all these Zabbix extra packages, as they will provide me with more metrics. Cool. Now I have the Zabbix agent running on this router, just one more thing to tweak. By default, the server IP address from which the agent accepts connections is set to the local host address, 127.0.1, in the agent's config file. So I need to replace that with the address of the Zabbix server. I do this over SSH with this little set command here. Also, I now need to restart the Zabbix agent service. Done. After a minute or so, the status of the host changes from gray or red to green. Zabbix is now collecting data from it. I can click on the latest data link and view the data points that Zabbix has already collected. I can even graph them already. Okay, not much to see after a couple of seconds, but it works. I want to draw your attention to the fact that Zabbix is already collecting over 160 data points from this single device. That's because the templates have a large number of discovery rules. Imagine how long this would take me to build 160 data point collections by hand. Hooray for templates! On a Debian server, like this Rundeck server here, the Zabbix agent can be installed using apt. apt install Zabbix-agent, then I launch the same set statement. Just this time, the config file is in a slightly different location. Restart the service. Done. After a minute or so, again, the host is available in the hosts list. Beautiful. At this point, I just want to make a remark on manual Zabbix agent installation. You have seen that there is a bit of config work to be done on the client. That's probably not a problem if you install the agent on two or three machines. You only need to do it once forever. Nevertheless, if you want to implement this in a larger environment that is maybe rapidly changing, then I really recommend using something like Ansible for the distribution of the agent. I will make a video on Ansible very shortly. If you are already using it, then please see the Ansible playbook on my GitHub repository. Right, now we are monitoring everything with Zabbix. To round this thing up, let's add some alerting to our Zabbix installation. First, I need to decide what should trigger an alert. I certainly don't want to receive a text message when a machine goes high on CPU for a minute. But I do want to be alerted when the real bad stuff happens. For this, the severity of problems in Zabbix comes in handy. If we look at the dashboard again, then we can see that these problems have different severities. I'll talk about that high memory utilization warning in a minute. So in a nutshell, I could say, I want to receive alerts whenever something happens that has a severity of high or disaster. Let's do that. And guys, we will only touch a fraction of this. For a full documentation of the features here again, see the Zabbix documentation, this time chapter 10, notification upon events. The first thing I do is that I configure the ways or media, as it is called in Zabbix. I click on administration, then media types here in the Zabbix UI. There's a vast choice. Text message, Discord, email, Telegram. I can even add my own media type, which can be email, SMS, so text message on the GSM phone if I have a modem attached to the server. It could be a script or a webhook, so that can do virtually anything really. But let's stick to the existing ones. Let's configure email for starters. I just need to type in all the parameters of my email server here. Once I have configured that, I then go to administration, users, and then the user I want to add that media type to. So let's say the admin here. I click on the media tab and add the corresponding media type. For instance, email. Last but not least, I need to tell Zabbix who to alert depending on which condition. This is done under configuration, actions, trigger actions. We already have a disabled entry here called report problems to Zabbix administrators. Let's use this one. There is a conditions box here. Let's add a condition. I want to be alerted when the trigger severity is greater than or equals the high severity. Next, I go over to the Operations tab and here I tell Zabbix what to do if the condition matches. The nice thing here is that there are operations that can be triggered when the problem occurs and also operations for recovery, so when the problem has gone away, and update operations. On the operations details, I can now define users, groups or single users and many more parameters like which media to use, how often to send, etc. Just don't forget to tick the enable box. And now I will receive notifications whenever something really bad happens in the environment. Awesome! Just two things before we close. Some real life scenarios where Zabbix has helped me save time and headache. I've already shown you the ever-growing log scenario in the beginning. That's a quite common thing. I have roughly 20 containers running 24/7 in my environment, and I really don't look into the Proxmox UI every day. So getting alerted when the disk needs to be resized is really handy. Another typical one is this VDR container where my SAT TV used to run on. If I monitor the memory usage long term, like over a month or two, then you can see that over time the memory is just eaten up. That's a quite common problem with software written in C or C++, where the software does not free up the memory after allocation properly, so-called memory leaks. You can only identify them if you monitor long term. How long would it take me to debug the software and fix the issue? Probably weeks. Or I just take the quick and dirty operational approach and just restart the services every 30 days. Not clean, but it works. And everyone is happy. Another common scenario is identifying bottlenecks. Look at my Shinobi CCTV container here. It has a quite constant CPU utilization, but if I figured out that there would be bottlenecks long term, then I could just add another CPU core to the container, or I could do the opposite, of course. If I see that it is over-provisioned, then I could just remove one. One last remark with regards to the high memory utilization warning in the dashboard here. The default Zabbix Linux template does not collect memory and CPU correctly from LXC containers. I had to define another template for that. I put a link into the description or on the GitHub repository. That's it, guys. There would be so much more. Let me know in the comments if you want follow-ups or anything. Thanks so much for watching and, like always, please stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.